Lodestar Initiative, and BPN. He completed his bachelor's in engineering from IIT Kanpur and his master's in management from IIM Bangalore. He started his career with Parle as a product manager. In the early 1990s, he set up Lodestar, India's first specialized media planning and buying outfit. He led the setting up of India's first media research and tools development cell at Lodestar. He's also chairing the technical committee of the BARC. He was featured in 2012 as the top 50 most powerful people in the city of Mumbai in a survey done by Daily News and Analysis newspaper. IAA India chapter has bestowed the prestigious Media Person of the Year award on him in 2013. Thank you so much, sir, for joining us.
Thank you. It's very embarrassing. I don't know where you got it from. I'm normally reticent, but thanks a lot for the lovely introduction.
No, it's our pleasure, sir. So as we all know, the Indian M&E sector, and we were talking about also about it, in terms of advertising, has taken a massive hit due to the pandemic. With things now becoming to look better, mainly with IPL and the festive season also approaching, how do you see a recovery to take place in the coming quarters? Do you feel that in terms of the advertising expenditure levels, we have got back to 2017-18 levels?
So 17-18 is actually too far back. Definitely, we are back at those levels. But if you see where we were last year, 2019, I suspect, so the sentiment is very positive. I mean, from what the beating we took in the first quarter, April, May, June, we are far, far more positive in sentiment. But the actions may not necessarily be in line with that sentiment. So, you know, especially with Diwali. So Diwali, what's happened? We had a very strong IPL. IPL has done very well. And in fact, I was quite surprised and presently surprised that IPL sold out, as you know. You know, all the digital companies and the e-com companies which are there, the e-platform companies, which are most of it, 60% of them. So that's done very well. There has been some degree of cannibalization from the entertainment channels onto that. But overall, the festive is all right. I'm not sure it's come back to what it was last year. If you take the IPL effect away, because remember, IPL last year was in April, May. So yes. If you take that away, like to like, I'm not sure we are back to 2019 level. I worry for the next quarter. I mean, I'm an optimist by nature, but it's best to be real in these circumstances. And I worry post Diwali to March. And I explain to you why. You know, this for a lot of companies, both the global and Indian companies, are year closing. So they've taken a beating in their profits. And obviously, whatever we may say, advertising is one expense when people always want to hold back to a certain extent to shore up their bottom line. So I suspect that December for global companies and Jan, Feb, March for Indian companies may be a bit slow, especially companies who've taken a massive beating this year. So their spends are going to be low. But I think the larger picture, I mean, just like 6 months have passed in the pandemic, if you look at the larger picture, I'm very hopeful that April onwards, not only because the infections will come down, hope infections were a good sign, so India's opening up. But not only that, but even there'll be fresh budgets, fresh momentum, people will want to pick back the momentum. So I think from April 2021 onwards, we should be in a very good place.
Okay. Naturally, from April 2021, you see the actual road to recovery
happening. Correct. And we should, you know, we should be actually ahead of, course, the base will be low because this base is not. So if you go to April 2019, 2020 is not a benchmark. Well, that's a disaster year. But if you look at year to year, month to month, and year to year, April 2019, we'll be better off.
Sure. That's encouraging to you, I would say. Now, sir, there's a lot of controversy around news, and the advertisers are willing to cut down on advertising on news channels if they continue to air such aggressive and hateful content in the name of news. Do you think that this nudge, you know, from advertisers would make news channels do course correction?
So there are two parts to this, and you know, I have to choose my words carefully. I'm in the thick of it, as we were the largest buyers, and you know, we were collateral damage to this whole exercise. So we were quizzed, Mr. Batsara, and we were quizzed in detail. So I'm handling it carefully, being a global company. But if I speak from my heart, I genuinely feel, whether advertising or otherwise, people should introspect. All the news broadcasters, and we've spoken to all of them. They've spoken to all of us. All the big names. I think a certain amount of introspection should happen, you know. Mm-hmm. It's good for the country, it's good for what we're doing. Otherwise, people are switching off, you know. I mean, people are not watching news. And that's the biggest damage they can do to themselves and to the country. Finally, you need news. They should. Whether they will or not, I think there's a fair degree of realization among themselves that they are hurting. Mm-hmm. But the problem, Kailash, if I may call you that, is that they have become polarized. So at this point in time, they've taken strong positions and they don't know how to get out of those positions, you know. and without naming names, because I've spoken to most of them, and in fact, perhaps all of them in my various capacities. So I think for the next 1 or 2 months, and we don't know, it's like a political case with the police involved, with CBI involved, we don't know which way to go. But my personal opinion is that if better sense prevails, if there arise, that, probably end of the year or January, new resolutions will be formed. And hopefully they will. Because, you know, just now, the effect of advertising has not been so dramatic. But at some point in time, I'm sure advertisers start asking questions, and they will, just now a few advertisers have already taken action.
Yes.
But I'm sure a lot of advertisers will start asking questions if this prolongs for the next 2-3 months. And I want to add one more point. And I speak as an industry. You know, this is the business of news is very fragmented. There are tons and tons of news channels, 16, 17 English channels, 30 odd Hindi channels, many, many regional channels, you know. However, on the media buying side, there's 5 of us who contribute almost 90% of television, 95% of television, you know. And some of us have been debating and discussing. If you hear what I'm saying, you may not really hear, but you may see read my lips. But we are saying that, you know, we'll wait and watch to a certain extent. Beyond that, things have to improve.
Absolutely.
So long-winded answer to a simple question you asked, I hope the message is clear.
Absolutely. No, and it calls for certain, you know, internal introspection on their part also, that more than the advertisers, if the consumers today are talking about it, you know, very openly on the social media, that this is not the kind of news that they want to watch, then it sends a good message. So as we know about the Tanishq ad controversy, and as the dust now has settled on that particular controversy, do you think that it gives a message about why good marketing doesn't always have to be about driving conversations? You know, woke advertising has worked for many brands, but isn't it a double-edged sword? They're, you know, playing on this thin line.
So I think there are 2-3 things to this, you know, and if I may, there are 2 questions within the question you have asked. So driving conversations is one, woke advertising is another, you know. So I think driving conversations is absolutely critical, because that's what engagement comes from, you know, you build up critical mass. Now, anyone who explores new dimensions, you know, which are there and which probably Tanishq explored, will be careful, because unfortunately, and I'm again saying from a personal point of view, I'm not questioning the merits or demerits of the case. All I'm saying is this country has become very thin-skinned. The ability to see humor, though I'm not saying this is humor or this is accepted, but very, very, you know, to condone, to hear another point of view, to react, is always reaction one way. And brands are in a very peculiar position. And you know, as I'm told in this case, people were being threatened in the staff, only that much companies and brands can do. You know? Having said that, driving conversation is still a very strong way of engaging advertising, whether this way or the other. For example, I've worked with Amul, you know, all the time in the pandemic, they've been doing a lot of stuff on driving conversation. You may say simple stuff in terms of chefs and recipes and all that. Or, you know, we have done some great work for Swachh Bharat, you know, which is all about driving engagement and conversation. So I think driving conversations in the long run is the only way to go, because attention spans are reducing, people are not watching content as much on television. You need to have a binder effect, be on television, be on mass media, also be on social media. So conversation is the only way to go. So that is now in our DNA. It's just that you have to be careful. There will be some people will always object to whatever you say.
Yes. And
so that's
the thing. Absolutely. So some people, I mean, but naturally, companies, while, you know, crafting a message that they want to send out, have to be a bit careful. But at the same time, it should not stifle any creativity.
Absolutely.
You know,
so if I add, one more point, and this is the point, in fact, I've seen a lot of my clients, advertising decisions are taken at different levels, you know. And I firmly believe that advertising is a senior man's call. And the recent controversy is a true example of that. So once the senior man backs it, you know, so firstly, a senior man, not because he's a title of a CEO or whatever, but he will have a perspective which is wider and an experience which is on his side. And the other advantage is once he backs it, then he probably will think through that, you know, if God forbid something is to happen, what would be the effect, you know? So ownership will be there, and also perspective will be there. So it's not that's not what I expected out of this controversy. But But I'm saying probably in a lot of companies now, advertising agencies should be at senior levels, you know, CEO or thing, not at just brand manager levels. They are normally senior levels, but ownership has to be there. And that, I think, will solve a lot of issues.
Absolutely, absolutely. So that's the ownership has to be there, as you rightly mentioned. So as we now see that, you know, urban markets are towards saturation. Now, be it in terms of consumption on TV or even in digital OTT, and there is a shift now of advertising or demand from urban tier 2 to tier 3 or the real Bharat, as we call it. What kind of transformation of shift will we see in terms of advertising campaigns as well or advertising platforms in times to come?
Very good question. So I tell you, this is a question dear close to my heart. It's a fundamental shift happening in this country. See, first I want to add a layer to your question before I answer what you're saying. You see, everyone says India is a young country. Yeah, think about it. India has been seen as one. There's no one India. There are many Indias. If you see actually the demographic dividend, as they say, or the young age is in the Indo-Gangetic plain, which is the Hindi-speaking belt, all the way from, you know, Delhi all the way to Bengal. That's where the young are. Yeah, so that's one point. Secondly, what mass media has done, whether it's television or whether it is digital, is equalize everything. So the aspirations and needs are the same. Whether you're a young kid, 24-year-old sitting in Bombay in terms for a job or is entertainment needs or whatever it is, or a guy sitting in, say, you take a small town or what you call it, class two town, hey, I mean, whatever in UP or Bihar, wherever, it's the same aspirations, you know. And probably the guy in small town India has a greater desire and need to reach there. The guy in Bombay is probably, you know, softened up. He's got a comfortable life. And a very senior marketer in India who's global repute to now, you know, ex-managing director of a company, Pidilite, Bharat Puri, explained this to me very well many, many years back. He's a CEO in background. And we came up, you know, we came up one way. And now we're comfortable. So obviously, and he created a formula without going into the details of the formula. So obviously, the desire is a lot more there. The exposure is very high. What digital has done is allowed you fulfillment also very high. So whether you want to purchase or consume, e-commerce companies are delivering there, you know. So firstly, you didn't have the range, into the choice, into the variety. If you want to do a program, which is an education, today everyone is available to him. So I think there's a fundamental shift which has happened and has got accelerated by the pandemic, that people have become a level playing field, you know. And you will find, see in your business, talent. Today, a lot of talent is coming to Bombay, but they all came from outside. Your writers, be it, you know, whatever, the entertainment industry. So across industries, you'll find this happening. And with work from home, if someone sitting in a small town somewhere in Madhya Pradesh can work from home as effectively, and we run a back office. And I, for the love of me, used to work for a global company. You know, we shoot analytics for them. And I used to wonder, why is it in Bombay such an expensive place and no talent is not found? Now, work from home, we have shifted and those boys are all over. Someone in Jaipur, someone in Alwar, somewhere where they're working from there. So, damn good. So, the larger point I'm making is this democratization of aspirations and democratization of needs and wants and values will be all over the country. And that will ensure that demand shifts. You must also, a word of caution, that of course, just now it's accentuated because the aspirations and needs being done in small town India, big town India slows down. Well, even though today, whatever lockdown effect is still in the big town India. So it's not that there'll be overnight shift one way. So once big town India opens up, urban India, I mean, the metro India opens up, there will be. But fundamentally, it's a long-term shift which will happen. And those companies who have got the supply chain, distribution, communication, product design, all that handled there, they will gain.
Absolutely. Naturally. So it's more about, you know, as you rightly said, the aspirations are there. And now with the data explosion, the data reaching to them, they have means to satisfy their end.
Absolutely.
Of the kind of desires that they have. Now, sir, let's talk about sectors within the M&E sector. Television being the biggest sector amongst the M&E sector. Television consumption, as we all know, grew considerably with the onset of lockdown. We saw some nostalgia on our national broadcaster as well. But, you know, this did not translate into ad revenues. As you rightly mentioned that we are somewhere seeing signs of recovery, but April, May, June was the worst. Now, do you feel that now festive season is there? We spoke about IPL. There are some big ticketing shows like KBC and Big Boss returning back to television. Television will be able to go back to its prime glory in terms of ADEX, or do you see some permanent damage happening to television?
No. So I think India still has headroom for television. I am not looking at Kailash in the vision of 3 months, 6 months. I'm looking at a slightly broader horizon for the next 2-3 years. I think there's a lot of juice left in television. So while OTT is growing and OTT will continue to grow, but television has for 2-3 reasons. Firstly, television is a big advantage. It is a lowest common denominator. And today for TV, even today, India 90%, while mobile phone is there, but 90% homes are single TV homes, maybe higher than 90%. You know? And that economic reality is not going to change in a hurry. So I think consumption, because someone in the home is going to be watching, family consumption will happen. So and penetration is only 65-70% of television. So there's enough headroom. Unlike the rest of the world, there is enough headroom for television here. The trick is engaging content. It may get segmented. So today I ask myself this question, why is that content which is on OTT not possible on television? Why can't you have the same content coming onto television? So today, you know, because television is, because of ratings, become a lowest common denominator. So all content is one kind, you know, and so to speak, what they call niche content and work, you don't want eyeballs. But in my mind, there are, see, the advantage of ratings, so you can always measure. The disadvantage is ratings have become very mass-based. You know, they don't favor top-end segment. I'm sure the ratings will evolve. I've been working with Bach. I'm sure there'll be development they'll do to ensure that better quality, you know, audience is also measured. So net-net, I'm saying that they will definitely, finally in this country, advertising fuels their content, you know. So on OTT, there is some subscription happening, but finally it's advertising. And advertising will chase measurement. So I still feel for a variety of reasons, there is headroom in television. Having said that, other segments will grow, definitely. I think OTT has a very bright future. The trick is, you know, these are common people like you and a lot of others, they're common owners of platforms, whether it's television and thing. How to marry the two is a trick. So just now people are doing a big thing on OTT. They're all taking a leaf forward in OTT, whether it's Hotstar or Z5 or whoever, you know. They're taking a hit there. But a stage will come where they'll have to marry eyeballs. They'll have to figure out why do I entice content with people, you know. So in the same family, I have to segment. Just now there are two separate segments. There's an OTT segment and there is a TV segment. You say, listen, how do I ensure that in the same family, the mother is on television or the family is on television, but a young girl or a young boy is also at the same time watching similar OTT content. That is the next stage of evolution which will happen.
Sure. So television has a big headroom considering the fact that we have 200 million homes have access to television in this nation. Yeah. And there is still room for more 60-70. So television is here, but yes, what kind of television will attract the millennials? That will depend upon content.
Absolutely.
The kind of content they serve.
Well,
and how best the marriage can happen between television is something which the platform owners have to see. Now, you know, a lot has been said, sir, regarding the fact that, you know, as unlike the West, we are very advertising dependent, be it television, OTT, you know. Your people are not having the habit, and this is a very age-old discussion which is happening. People do not have the habit to pay for what they watch. Now, in a situation where we saw this kind of pandemic, and for majorly for the FTA channels, they lost their ground. I mean, if you talk about the first 4-5 months, it was near a broth that close to 80-85% revenues were eroded. Now, how to balance that? How to balance the fact that you can have advertising revenue as well as subscription revenue? Because a pure FTA channel only depends upon advertising.
Right.
How even they can marry the fact?
It's a tough question. So it's really a tough question, Kailash. I mean, I wish there were easy answers. But I genuinely believe that there is a way. India finally has to go with the rest of the world, where whatever the value, but in terms of volume, there has to be a subscription model in place. Yeah. And a stage will come, because today everyone's throwing it away free. Everyone's giving everything. I mean, look at our advances in time, cell phone costs. The cost for making a call was so cheap, and now they're talking of it, a lot of you know, taking up prices. So India, because there's entry barriers, it's a free market on everything, including entertainment, every channel is here. The other day, Mr. Manish Tiwari wrote a lovely piece in one of the papers on this whole rating controversy, I don't know if you read it, where he said there's so many channels. You know, there was some way of restricting. So I think finally consumers will realize that they have to pay for good content. And if differentiated content comes, people will pay. They may not pay international prices, but they will pay. But I think solutions have to be found which are, you know, in a way marry the two. The government has a role to play. I mean, if you see IPL rights, sports all over the world, sports has a fair degree of subscription or, you know, in its revenue models. The revenue for advertising difference, you can't afford such high bidding costs. Yes. I'm sure Star also, when they bid for IPL, had that in mind. Correct. But the way the subscription has paid out because of at some point pressures. So I think it's smartly done. I may say so directly. ERAI also has a role to play in its desire to please consumers. They have a role to play in this whole pricing which they've done. But I think better sense will prevail. Sometimes sense will prevail. That goes back to your other question on what's happening on news, living and renting, which is happening. But the economic models don't work out right. Business will collapse. So I personally am very hopeful that there will be a middle ground, both from the government side, also from the consumer side. It will be a two-way approach. It won't be this madness which is happening just now. That will solve.
Sure. So it's like that somewhere India has to follow the West model.
Correct.
And consumers, as per our, you can say, as per our economy and purchasing power, that is when, as per our inflation, the consumer will have to pay for the kind of content that he sees.
The ratio may never be 50-50, but even if it's 60-40 or 70-30, it's very good.
It's very good. It's very good. So your dependence on just one particular stream of revenue
Absolutely. Declines.
Otherwise, it's such kind of situations may just throw you out of the park.
Yeah.
If we talk about print now, sir, it is the second largest factor of advertising expenditure. And lockdown has caused a great dent to it when it comes to circulation and impacting its ad as well as subscription revenues. Now we see, yes, print coming back. But, you know, 4-5 months when circulation was not there, at least in the urban areas, when there were negligible ad revenues, zero subscription revenues, it's a long enough, you know, time for a habit formation. Like if I give you my example, I was an avid reader of newspapers pre-COVID in the morning after getting up. But nowadays I realize, you know, I'm in the double mind. Should I call for a newspaper? I get my news on time. So now if this kind of, you know, questioning prevails in the minds of the Indian consumers, where do you see the future of mainstream and regional print?
Tough question. So if I were them, I'd be very, very concerned. So I tell you, I break this into two parts, the metros and the small town India. I'm purposely not calling it urban rural, but I'm saying metros and small town India. Small town India, there is enough headroom for, you know, as you know, newspapers today again are dependent because the cover price is so low. You know, exactly the question we were talking about television is applicable for, and I don't know if your viewers in this program, it's very interesting. Most newspapers except the South in Kerala and other places and Tamil Nadu sell for 3-4 rupees cover price. The paper size which they are, they normally make a loss of 6-7 rupees per paper. So all that loss and the profit comes from advertising. Is that dramatic a situation? You know, if you guys were talking about your problem, newspaper is very bad, you know. So I think consumers are willing to play all in the desire for numbers. And I've said this to many, from the old school, so I understand newspapers, I'm on some of the boards, I'm very fond of them. So I've said, listen, you have to start improving cover price. And this is industry action. You know, you cannot, see, there is a concept I want to explain to your viewers, which I strongly believe in, that you're an industry. So you compete, I compete, you compete with, I compete with my competitors, Rupam or whatever, Madison. You compete with others. But there's a larger ecosystem, which in Hindi we call it Biradri.
Biradri.
If you come together as a Biradri, then you know, so I've said to them, I said, pick up a state, pick up UP. Try your experiment. That, you know, your advertisers are coming not because you have, say, a circulation of, say, whatever, 20 lakhs, 30 lakhs, large numbers. They're coming because you're reaching to the right audience in a credible manner. Your news is credible. Now, the 30 lakhs comes to 25 lakhs, doesn't matter. But take the cover price up. At least you change the balance of the subscription and advertising ratio which you were talking about earlier. So, this is the concept of Biradri. It's difficult to get them together. They will come, but at least they'll have an alternate revenue stream which is sizable. And like I said in my earlier reference to the youth of India and Bharat, as you called it, you know, there is merit because there's desperate desire to learn. And newspapers can play a critical role in credibility and all that. A lot of stuff is coming out today, especially in the last 6 hours. You don't know how much, how reliable it is. I mean, I see, I'm there in all the forms of news, whether it's a television or whether social media. But finally, I get assured in the morning when I read the newspaper that this is right or this is wrong, you know. So that's the credibility part. So I think there is enough juice if the industry comes together, rallies around, creates these experiments. And what I'm saying is nothing new. We have spoken in our bodies. We have spoken about this, you know, taking cover price up, doing experiments, whether 3 rupees should become 5. South already, Kerala, there's no problem. The cover price is 10 rupees and the subscription is not dropped. So, you know, I don't know. So they're making money. The problem, which is a fundamental problem in the metros. Here, what you said, habit change. So what I exactly allude to, you are my target group for the hypothesis I'm building. Habit is broken. You're in the internet. You know, that big newspaper feed is gone. A lot of advertisers is one of my largest e-commerce. I work with one of the largest companies in the country in advertising spends, is a large e-commerce company. And the CMO, they asked a question. He said, listen, seeing it on mobile, seeing my ad on mobile or a handheld device is not the same as seeing it in the full glory of a double spread, which I see. So I would be worried. And, you know, my suggestion, which I made to many print owners, is that unless you embrace digital, and unless, you know, you talked of conversations earlier in other context of brands, I'm saying unless newspapers in the metros, the big English-speaking newspapers, or even the language ones, embrace digital in a strong way, you know, and then start, you know, take the main print, they have advantage of credibility, they have a platform, they can start doing tailor-made content, you know, then they reach out to you. You probably think of different. Why should Google and Facebook give you that content which they can do? Why should Daily Hunt give you that content? You know, and the point is, you know, and look at their mindset. Their mindset is different. If you remember, some time back, they put out about 3 months back in the middle of this pandemic, they put out a story and I complained. I said, what's wrong with you guys? Saying if you're getting e-papers, you know, if we found it's illegal, we'll catch you. And you're not delivering physical papers at home. On the other hand, you're saying e-papers is illegal. You are killing your own franchise. You're killing the habit, exactly point you're making. So I think the industry has to evolve. If they don't evolve, I'd be worried for the metros. I feel there's lots of juice left in the small town India.
इंसान सुबह उठता है, चाय की टपरी पे जाता है, कटिंग चाय लेता है, पार्ले जी लेता है और खोल के अपना अखबार
पढ़ता
है. Yes, for the urban India, there is a bit of thinking that the industry as a whole must do. Now, if we talk about the booming segment, the digital segment, which includes your video on demand, OTT, everything. Consumption has gone through the roof. You have newer set of audiences joining in post the lockdown. Digital advertising was growing at 32% last year. Now it forms a part like close to 23% of your entire adex. Do you feel that has this pandemic become a boon to an already growing segment, or and that it will overtake television sooner than it was projected earlier?
I personally am one of the, I mean, the most fashionable thing to say is that, but I personally am not going to say that. You call me old fashioned or whatever. There are a few reasons I'll give you. Firstly, see, there is no third party measurement. Finally, when advertisers, see, firstly, there's a whole digital story, na? As my teams explained to me very nicely, the digital is in two parts. There is display, which is like advertising, and there is all the performance part, right? So when pressure came on brands, they spent, and the mindset of clients and brands is different. So they say, give me dhanda. Dhanda is performance. You know, so whatever they did, search and whatever they did in performance. Display is a part of brand building. And display, if the budgets have come down, you know, so while I know people is fashionable to say digital went up, but display, you break up into segments. I'm not sure display went up as dramatically. So if my client X, say a client is X, if he has crashed his budget on brand building by say 50%, so chances are digital display also will come down, not 50%, come down 30%, 20%. Yeah. So this is a bit of a hype being built around digital. Nothing wrong in that. I mean, digital is the future. But there are two parts of digital. Now, display also performance, at least you know what numbers you're getting. You're getting some feedback. You're getting your CRM mechanism, your platform, Salesforce or whatever. On display, there's no such thing. Nielsen does some data, how many people have seen. But there's no third-party measurement like Bob. Also, remember, whatever is speaking at television has a very robust third-party measurement. Yes. So till that third-party measurement comes, you know, who's watching? So owners put out, I'm saying nothing wrong in owners putting out, platform owners put out what the data. But finally, reliability will always come from third-party measurement. When third-party measurement comes, it will hamper the growth of display vision. Search and performance definitely will come.
Absolutely. So a third-party, like as you rightly said, that you know, television has a credible measurement system. You have a third-party where you come to know what your audience, who all are watching, how much are they watching, where are they watching, where are they not watching. For digital, yes. And even if you talk about, you know, subscription of digital, like there are certain platforms which are just subscription driven. There are AVOD plus SVOD. Now, if we talk about the entire universe, I was reading a number which says that only 10 million, the entire OTT universe, if we talk about OTT, the paid OTT universe, entire universe is 10 million.
Absolutely.
In which everyone is there. Everyone has a pie of that 10 million, which is a very small number.
Yeah.
If you have to talk about an entire subset of an M&E sector. So for that to grow and alongside advertising also to grow, yes, you need a verifiable system. And then, of course, it is a growing segment. But naturally, in order to overtake television, there is still some time.
That's very well said. So let me elaborate on this point, time permits. So, you know, it's the pyramid. And probably you're throwing numbers and you're clarifying better than I did. But if you see the pyramid, television is other than 1 billion, everything down below is people like us or our lookalikes say that, you know, we're not watching television because we're part of that 1 million. But the fact is there's a huge opportunity below that 1 million or 1.5 million, whatever the number may be, to all the way down. Now, you may overlap. So you may say 1.5 million to 3 million or 5 million. What kind of content do I give them that they watch television, they also watch OTT? So it's a content strategy, and which is the point I was making earlier, that you're sitting in a family and you're watching a serial, you know, the whole family is watching, but the daughter is told, listen, she sent a message, there is a special cut for you on the serial. Serial is a different ending for you. Think about it. I'm making it up. But the point I'm making is, so how do you have a multiplicity of viewership of TV and this is not either or. Today, it's become either or, you know. So that is the way, and platforms are common. The Z's and the Stars and the Sony's and all of you guys. You guys are all common. So if you could decide that, you know, how do we wean it away? Below that 1 million, there's a huge opportunity, which is where the future is.
Absolutely. Sir, if we not talk about cinema and live events, they have come to a grinding halt. Yes, cinemas have been allowed to open up with, you know, certain SOPs in place, 50% capacity, but still there are no new releases as of now.
Yeah.
As far as this financial year goes, yes, for cinema it is sort of a complete washout, and live events, as we all know, are literally zero. Now, a large section of movies, you see that they are directly releasing on digital, on your OTT platforms. Will such an opening up, the grading opening up of cinemas, generate an interest level for advertisers as well as for consumers, do you feel? Or how much time will cinema,
sure,
you know, take to come back to that 70mm experience?
I doubt it's a long haul, because in India, the gestation period for productions are very high, you know, 18 months. So the cycle has been broken, and a lot of these guys are still not on the floor, as you said, and still not on the sets. Other than a couple of stars, most of them are still reticent, you know, the crews are not back, rightly so. So I think because the way Indian cinema, especially in the Hindi spectrum, especially Bollywood, the way it's constructed, it's a long haul process. And as I was discussing, in fact, coincidentally, with some of the people in the industry yesterday, and the TV industry has adapted a lot faster. And the TV industry has migrated to OTT. The people on OTT are a lot more on the fringe of cinema. So in the short run, to answer your question, it's going to be a tough haul for the cinema. The good news is, like I keep talking about democratization, democratization will happen here, be it of, you know, stars, be it of, see, the band is increasing. It's not that those five guys who are doing all the movies. The stars are going up, you know, so you'll have better content. India has always been star-driven because of cinema. But now, OTT will ensure that it's, you know, finally true people like you who are writers, you know, creators will come into the fore. So I think it's a short-term pain, but it's damn good for the industry. It will ensure that, just like I keep talking about democratization of consumption, democratization of production will also happen. Democratization of creative will also happen. So sure. I think it's a great opportunity, but it'll hurt in the short run for the reasons you mentioned.
In the short run, there is pain, but there's no reason to lose hope for cinema.
Absolutely.
Because as we rightly said, you have your India and you have your Bharat. which is waiting to throng
the cinema. Small movies coming on, you know, instead of the big movies coming, the whole structure will change. You'll have smaller movies who will become hits in their respective regions. They don't have your pan India release, so it could be many things.
Absolutely. You know, sir, once a segment which has undoubtedly caught everyone's attention is the online gaming. There were numerous amounts of downloads during the lockdown, and especially the April, May part, where, you know, people had formed the habit of staying at home and they didn't know that we have to go out, and even work was slow. So now, like, what happened in July, August was, like, yes, offices were shut, like, majority of the offices were shut, but you don't have that hunky-dory days of April and May where, you know, even work calls were not there, mails were not there. As we were talking about habit formation in print, here also a habit got formed of online gaming. Although it's a very small contributor of the addicts yet, do you see that this is the dark horse?
It could be. So internationally, it's a big segment, gaming is. And not only from an addicts point of view, also from subscription point of view and the way this played out, the money is made. So for a variety of reasons, it's a sizable segment. In India, it's been small. And finally, you're absolutely right. It's caught on. And it's coming on from both sides. You know, the advantage of gaming is that it's coming from the big, big bold IPL kind of cricket kind of games, you know, fantasy leagues which are there. I mean, all over them. I've never seen so many spring up in any one category, so many players crop up in the span of 6 months, 8 months, as they have in cricket. So that's one. And also the games which you alluded to, which we were all familiar growing up, the Ludos of the world and stuff like that. So I think it's a wide spectrum. So I think it really is a dark horse because, you know, it's habit forming, it's time spent is very high. You know, once you're hooked on, you can't get out of it. So I think definitely as a category is going to be big. Whether for advertising or not, I don't know. The promoting is some players will fall by the wayside and from addicts point of view. But definitely it's a here to stay category.
I mean, it's something to look out for. And you know, a very interesting point since we are talking about IPL, sir. The principal sponsor of an IPL is an online gaming platform.
Absolutely, absolutely.
So that is the first change that we see.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
5 years back, who could have imagined that Dream Eleven will be the
An online sponsor. Gaming platform is the principal sponsor of IPL. I'll move towards my last question, sir. So BARC, and you're also with the technical committee of BARC, which provides the currency of the industry, received firstly suggestion and directives from the Telecom Regulatory Authority of India over its measurement system and governance structure. Now, this came at a time when the industry was facing its worst froth ever due to the pandemic. Also, there is a rating controversy which clouds over it. How do you respond to this, considering that BARC data is the only industry currency?
So, let me, as a passionate person who's involved in the setting of BARC from 2015 onwards, I've worked hard on it. Let me, it's a biased view, but I'll give you a view and use your platform to give a bit of a perspective. See, you know, contrary to what people believe, and I say this with pride, this is one of the best systems in the world. For 2-3 reasons. It's an industry body, you know. Very few markets in the world except France and maybe others have an industry body, which is all the stakeholders, which is agencies, clients, ISA, and broadcasters running it together. So the board is governed by them, all of them put together. That's the first point. The second point is the technology in play. The watermarking technology is phenomenal. I mean, it's used by Israeli fighter jets and stuff like that. It's very good technology. You know, it's more advanced than a lot of other markets. And the third, a lot of people say it's not representative, wrong. 45,000 is the largest panel. I mean, a country like China, which is far, far ahead of us, is, you know, not even, I think, less than half of our number of meters. It's all about statistics and the representation of the sample. So there are some very basic things which are right about it. And the guys who funded are very decent guys, the big broadcasters, you know, the networks, are very good people. The problem is that it's got into controversy on news genres, you know, and English news genres, and let me explain the genres. That at any point in time, prime time news watching, 1% people watch, as you know, English news. Now, 44,000 homes, that means 1% is 440 homes, correct? 440 homes divided between 16 channels. On an average, it's about 20-25 homes. So, and the rating, therefore, are rounding off, it was 0.2, 0.3, like that they are, you know, or 0.01. So the point is, these guys, unfortunately, in India, there's no self-regulation. People don't regulate themselves. The desire to, you know, game the system is very high. And the game, this is not for advertising because, as you know, news and niche genres are not bought on ratings. Because, you know, the level of error, the relative error is so high that most media panels know that, you know, there's no difference between one and the other. They're all the same. So there are rates, you know, and as I explained to many people that, you know, one child with the highest rate may not get the best rate because, you know, your perception, many other factors. So all this, in my personal opinion, if I say it strongly and I'm known for my candor, is all about egos, that I am number one, you know, they play on prime time. What they don't play, that they're number one of 0.1% rating or 1% rating. You know, so their share, they say we have 80% share, we have 70% share or 50% share. But 50% share of 1% or 50% share of 0.8%. So, you know, so it's an ego game to please their masters. And they've done undue damage. And I've said it to all the broadcasters. I think they're realizing, the first question you asked, that I think baht is a strong currency. And it's here. And God forbid if something is to happen, you know, if government is to get something to happen, because this is a dynamic time, anything can happen. It will hurt the industry. And my appeal would be, and I think they all realize in the heart of hearts, that this is a solid currency. You know, in India, there's no service. It's like a traffic signal. Now, five people in India jump the signal. You can't blame the system. You have a deadly system which is there, but someone is jumping the signal. He's jumping the signal. You can't. And it's powerful. He's well connected. So you can't even catch him. So it's sad. I genuinely believe that it's all about, in their mind, realization. I think some of the big broadcasters and news, particularly where this problem exists, are realizing that this is going to hurt the ecosystem. Again, my concept of biradari, that you may end up with the baby with the bathwater, and then they will rectify. So I am proud that the system is not to blame. The system is very well connected. And whatever Bach has to do, they will do the course correction. Whatever, you know, and as you know, we are working on how to ensure that the sample sizes, you know, people don't misrepresent. While we keep saying there's error levels are so high, no one talks about error levels. So we'll find a solution, which we will in the next 2 weeks, 3 weeks, we're supposed to find a solution. As you know, we have blocked news ratings. And we're supposed to come back at TechCom, and I run the TechCom, we'll come back with a solution. So we'll come. So all the loopholes we've plugged. But I think the big thing is the big news broadcasters are now realizing that there's a merit in, you know, there's a great body for, you know, someone's selfish gain. We shouldn't destroy the body. We shouldn't hurt the body. Not destroy, hurt the body. I'm sure realization will happen.
So, you know, for some people flouting the game, you cannot blame the system. The system is there. The system is robust. The system is working positively. And it is a data which one must and we all should rely on, because that is the currency of the industry, and that is verifiable, measurable, and it operates at a very professional and a very ethical level. With this, thank you so much, sir.
Thank you for joining on this episode. Thanks a lot. Thank you very much. Take care. All the best to you.
It's a complete pleasure. And thank you so much. Thank you so much, ladies and gentlemen, for also joining us this afternoon. And a special thanks to you, sir.